And to counter that, may I request Dr. Sushrut Babulkar will speak on the PFN.
My punchline is, when you are at war, you have to pick up your gun and fight. So when Chetan invited me to speak against DHS, I just decided to pick up the gun and fight. Of course, the classic, in an unstable fracture, you do a perfectly executed DHS and a derotation screw will remain a classic, and it will continue to stay like that till bony union for years together. There is absolutely no argument, no fight against a classic. So we all know that. We have used this for years. What a man, very respected in Pune. And thanks, Chetan, for inviting me over to fight against this man who put forth DHS very, very effectively. But let's look at what he has forgotten. 34% of patients today present with unstable situation like this and like this. And we have identified this in science, and I'm going to put forth to you science which talks about these 34% patients with reverse obliquity, transtrochanteric fractures, posterior medial fragment, and subtrochanteric extension. What do we do with these fractures? And as we all surgeons know, reduction is the buzzword. It's all about reduction. And we as surgeons need to set this right, the quality of reduction, so as to avoid complications. Of course, we have our weapon in hand, which we have used for years with all these augmentation devices. But do they work every time? Then, despite of using those, why has this happened? Of course, we have used this, DHS, augmentation. Still, can we predict these failures is the question. And this literature has shown that from 3%, there is an increased incidence to 22% when there is a lateral wall fracture. My friend, Dr. Bhagli, has forgotten completely about lateral wall fracture, which is bothering you and me today. So a DHS done here on day one looks fantastic. Look what happens. It just walks out. This is what we want to avoid today. We have nothing against DHS in a stable environment. We know the importance of intramedullary device, which has mechanical advantage, but it's not only because of its intramedullary placement, but it is because of the buttress that it provides against excessive fracture collapse, like here. Watch the collapse that occurs, and that is stopped by sheer intramedullary presence of an intramedullary device. So that's how it stops in a posterior medial fragment. So to some extent, intramedullary device will take away your tension of providing an additional augmentation in this situation. Even with lateral wall fracture, it will act as a incompetent lateral cortex to some extent. So that's the mechanical advantage it will produce. This very famous paper, which pitted nail versus plate, though it criticized plate fixation and suggested that nail and plate has equivocal results, it definitely showed the trend of all the surgeons going towards intramedullary device preference. Of course, it went to suggest that consensus of orthopedic literature is associated with a higher complication rate in intermediary devices, but it also suggested that people are preferring an intramedullary device in unstable situation. Again, Dr. Bhagli is not well aware about the latest classification systems. Now, with CT advantage, 3D CT scans, we have further classified the typical AOTA classification, and this has been published in Injury, where based on CT scan, we have definitely devised a plan with lateral wall fracture, posterior wall fracture, and a combination of burst fracture. So what happens? This is a typical fracture which looks so innocuous on X-ray. But the moment you do a CT scan, it will show you a lateral wall fracture. No way you can deal with a only DHS in this situation. And what you need to do in this lateral wall fracture is to simply put an intramedullary device and have a wraparound technique. minimal invasive, don't disrespect tissue biology and it will continue to heal. Give a consistent result. That's what we are talking of. More comminution on X-ray, CT scan will show like this. Just go ahead with intramural device, wrap around. Now this time a double wire technique, a longer nail, a consistent result till bone union. Reverse obliquity, comminution, you see the amount of comminution, a huge posterior wall fracture, a huge posterior medial fragment with avulsion of tip of trochanter with a double loop technique again. And the whole technique is done with a very small incision. You wrap around all the comminuted fragments and it will stay till it unites with a predictable amount of collapse without walking away of the implant. And that's what you want. It will continue to heal and make patient symptom free. Even with a divaricated fragment like this, do a simple wiring technique, reconstruct the lateral and posterior wall and have a predictable result. Again, a very controversial paper which discussed that intramural devices lead to better radiographic union but not definitely a functional outcome. How do we counter that? Of course, the tissue biology disruption, the third column, is extremely less with intramural device. We know that we can do it with very tiny incisions, even with the cerclage wire that is required with the advantage of synthesis wiring loop technique. You can do it with a very tiny incision. So that's what we are talking. We are trying to shy away from this scene while doing a DHS. That's what we don't want. Even with Indian implants, we can have a predictable result. Even with an imported implant or an Indian copy of PFNA2s, we can have a predictable result, and that's what we want. Milestone paper, multi-center, randomized controlled trial, published last month. Let's look at this. Journal of Orthopedic Trauma, published last month, looked at primary outcome measures, and what impressed me most was these two factors, functional independence measure and timed up and go test. Now we all know timed up and go test that we look at. Secondary outcome measures also this paper looked at was 2-minute walking test, femoral shortening, blood loss and mortality, etc. Let's look at, as an orthopedic surgeon, we don't understand all these measures. But let's look only at functional independence measure, which is an 18 items rated on a 7-level scale. It looked at across the section, all the types of fracture configuration and intramural device applied against DHS. What did it infer? In functional patients, not morbid patients, but patients who can give their opinion, those functional patients were having an improved outcome with intramedullary fixation. So this is what it is in unstable intertrochanteric fractures, which is 34% of the patients. Of course, if you don't do good reduction, the implant is not going to be your savior. So poor reduction has not to be accepted, whether you use DHS, whether you use intermediate device, or your choice. Construct lateral wall, pay attention to posterior wall, make sure that you have a meticulous surgical repair, whatever device you use, and then, especially in comminution situation, osteoporotic situation, it will stay. I do not have to say who is the winner now. Thank you.
Thank you, Shashrut.